who came from Poonamalli, who's a daily laborer by occupation, who came with the chief complaints of swelling over the right side of the neck for past 3 months and complaints of pain over the swelling for past 15 days. History of presenting illness, he was apparently normal 3 months back, after which he noticed the swelling in the right side of the neck, which was insidious in onset, initially small in size and gradually progressed to attain the current size and was associated with pain, which was pricking type of pain, intermittent in nature, no aggravating or relieving factor, not radiating. No, we didn't show.
You never
show.
Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
That's obvious. Okay. This is a pair. You're not supposed to do this. Anyway, carry on.
History of dysphagia present even to swollen saliva. History of hoarseness of voice present. History of loss of weight, loss of 6 kgs in the last 3 months. History of loss of appetite present. No history of evening rise in temperature, no history of chronic cough, no history of epistaxis, no history of halitosis, sharp tooth or recent tooth extraction, no history of breathlessness. Moving on to past history, patient was diagnosed with pulmonary tuberculosis, he was a defaulter for ATT, not a diagnosed case of diabetes mellitus, hypertension or CAD. Personal history. He's a chronic smoker for past 30 years, smoke cigarette one packet a day, and no reverse smoking, consumes alcohol for past 30 years. Personal history, family history, nil significant, nil surgical history.
Okay, you have mentioned a couple of things that is a little striking to us. You said he cannot swallow his own saliva. What do you mean by that?
Swallowing his own
saliva. What do you mean by that? In medical terms, what are you suspecting? What does it indicate? Difficulty in swallowing is what?
Dysphagia.
So what grade of dysphagia is this?
Grade 4.
This is absolute dysphagia. He can't even swallow his saliva. Okay, that is grade 4. Right? So you have to say that. Postgraduates, please use this layperson's language, all right, but certain things you can really say it. Like we said in the previous case, intermittent claudication is a terminology you should use straight away. So no need to beat around the bush. Be very specific. You asked history of reverse smoking. What for? What do you mean by that?
Reverse smoking is more common carcinoma of the heart palate.
Why? What do you mean by reverse smoking?
They smoke with the burn.
Yeah, the burnt end, you can speak on the mic. Sorry. Speak on the mic, yeah.
Sorry, ma'am. They smoke with the burning part within inside the mouth rather than the bud inside.
Right.
So this causes more irritation to the heart palate, more prone for heart palate cancers.
Okay, so it's a combination of both heat as well as you're inhaling all the toxic products of smoking. You're not exhaling it. So one is heat injury to the heart palate causing more heart palate tumors. Plus, they will have more than one tumor in the aerodigestive tract because of the constant inhaling of all the nicotine products, right?
He's not able to swallow his saliva, or he's not able to swallow his own saliva. I don't understand what it is. Huh? Own. No, the word. Do you understand? Is he going to swallow somebody
else?
That
is a scenario, probably a classical description of somebody sitting in the OPD with a handkerchief spitting out. That is a more apt. Did your patient do?
No,
if he is not able to swallow, as madam says, his own saliva. You remind me of Ilayaraja, who said, "Illinga, abdi or our chonna da jaap brother. Ourdeya saapta da aunglaaliye jirni kumdiyani Ilayaraja chonnar. As a doctor, ipande see if you are saying the patient is not swallowing his own saliva, that is an apt description, right? I concede it to you. Then they should be holding their kerchief and in the OPD they should be constantly spitting. We have a surgical gastroenterologist of repute, Dr. Rajendran, and his specialization is what that will remind to you, an OPD patient sitting with the spitting on a kerchief. It is a carcinoma esophagus, any esophagus lesion where they are not able to swallow beyond that cricopharynx, right? Okay. So you have to be very careful when you give vivid descriptions, right? Go ahead.
Moving on to general examination, patient is severely malnourished with BMI of 10 with ECOG score of 1, vital 78 per minute pulse rate, blood pressure 100 per 60 millimeters of mercury measured in the right upper arm in sitting posture, respiratory rate 20 per minute. Patient is pale. Moving on to general examination of the neck, after obtaining prior consent, patient exposed from chin below to the level of nipple, made in sitting posture, examined from the front of the neck, front of the patient. Upon inspection, swelling of size 6x5 cm, noted in the right side of the neck, extending superiorly, just below the level of angle of mandible on the right, inferiorly just above the right sternoclavicular joint, medially extending 1 cm just lateral to the midline and posteriorly beyond the right sternocleidomastoid muscle. The surface of the swelling appears nodular. No dilated veins, no visible pulsations or discharging sinuses. The swelling does not move on deglutition nor upon protrusion of tongue. No other swelling is visible elsewhere in the neck.
Right, your caption says inspection, but how do you pinch the swelling and inspection? Skin or the swelling is pinchable?
Yes, that was wrong, sir. We have to...
No, you are very fond of a new pinch and all that. You pinch so many people, so many places. But how can you do that on inspection, man?
No, sir. We are... Sorry, sir.
Okay, sorry. Yes.
It moves or does not move on deglutition or protrusion of tongue. Where does it come? Only the midline swelling which moves on deglutition. It is already lateral. How can you put that word? You're strong. What are the midline swellings which moves on deglutition?
It's coming towards the midline, man. The swelling is coming towards the midline.
See, I'd like just like to tell one point. No slide should be more than 6 lines.
Sorry.
If you go on putting 10 lines, 20 lines, nobody will see, nobody will read. They simply look somewhere else. So, you have the habit of only 6 lines, short. There is no history of now short scripts. You have to create your own words. Otherwise, nobody will follow your presentations. Go on putting 20 lines, nobody will follow.
And one more advice, whether you are writing a theory examination or clinical, you draw a diagram and that will tell you exactly what. No, this PowerPoint presentation, all that, you should have your own anatomical surface anatomy diagrams to lay out the PowerPoints and clinical. These are for the discussion sake, today's session sake. In university examination, as Professor Shanmugam said, you are not going to talk about investigative modalities, results and all that. You have to go and deal clinically and draw appropriate diagrams. Okay, go back.
This is what I said when you presented itself. It should not be horizontal. Everything has to be vertically placed in your slide.
Only points. Understand?
No sentences. It has to be points. Just the words and it has to be vertically down.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Now you got gone to palpation, yes.
Moving on to palpation, the trachea was deviated to the left, no localized warmth. Nodular swelling of size 6x5 cm seen in the right side of the neck, extending superiorly 2 cm below the angle of mandible on the right, inferiorly just above the right sternoclavicular joint, and medially 1 cm just lateral to the midline and laterally beyond the right sternocleidomastoid muscle. The swelling was variable in consistency. And upon putting the right sternocleidomastoid to taut, the plane of the swelling was found to be deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. The swelling was found to be fixed to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. And the swelling was minimally tender upon palpation. And another small swelling of size 2x2 cm was found just below and behind the right angle of the right side mandible, which was hard in consistency. And the left carotid was normal in position. Palpable normal in position and the right carotid was displaced posteriorly beyond the posterior border of the right sternocleidomastoid muscle. No other swelling was palpable elsewhere in the body. The opposite side of the neck, bilateral axilla and the left subclavicular lymph nodes were free. The patient was able to shrug his shoulders and no evidence of Farnes syndrome was noted. Inspection of the oral cavity proper.
Go back to the palpation previous slide. See, you are talking about left carotid, then talk about right carotid. Our lesion is on the right side, is it?
Yes, sir.
Then why do you talk about left carotid first? Swelling does not move with deglutition. Is it a midline swelling?
No, sir. That'd be
then why you talk about deglutition, protrusion of tongue and all that? That too in a short notes, you got to be very precise. Okay.
What is it that actually, what is this swelling?
Diagnosis.
What is it ultimately? You're going to show us what is it? Yeah, continue, finish presentation.
Yes, ma'am. And oral cavity proper, the no trismus, perm is 3 fingers. Poor oral hygiene, no dental caries, no ulcers or ulcer proliferative growth. Examination of the other system, and no deviation of tongue. Examination of the other systems, CVS and respiratory system was normal. And parabdomen, no splenomegaly, and left hydrocele was present. CNS, known for focal neurological deficits. So this is the swelling.
Okay. Go on.
Yes, ma'am. So he's a 73-year-old man with a short history of 3 months with swelling in the right side of the neck, which was rapidly progressing. So based on the history and the clinical examination, we would like to go for a neck secondary, saying it is a metastatic node.
So basically, they are lymph nodes that you lymph palpated.
Node. Yes, ma'am.
So it's again, it's a short case, like just like sir said, you can straight away said this group of lymph nodes are palpable. It's not a UG exam. You describe the swelling, tell the extent, this, that, and finally make a diagnosis of a metastatic node. Straight away, this group, lymph nodes are palpable, they are hard, they are fixed, whatever it is. Straight away, metastatic nodes. Why beat around the bush? Yes. So don't do that. Short case, no time.
And even an undergraduate will talk about levels. Yes. No, without even mentioning the word level, how are you going to describe and deal and convince us about the origin?
Level 1 is submental and submandibular. Level 2 is upper deep cervical. Level 3 is middle.
Sir? What levels are involved in this patient? Ma'am wants to know.
Level 2A and level 4.
Are they upper deep cervical, middle deep cervical,
yeah,
lower deep cervical?
Looks like.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Level 2A, 3 and 4, sir.
3 and 4.
Yes.
And the other swelling you said, that is?
The 2A was for the other swelling, sir.
Oh, mainly below, a component in upper deep cervical and 3 and 4.
3 and 4, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Skin involved or not? Skin.
No, sir.
Skin is pinchable.
Yes, sir.
In neck secondaries, you have to talk about two things. One, skin, another is platysma. Sometimes, platysma involvement can be seen separately as a elevated band-like lesion. These are all go to prove the lesion is more malignant. Somewhere in the history you said there is ATT.
Yes, sir.
Anti-tuberculous treatment also. So here, the second mass, is it a single mass or is it a conglomeration of mass? Was it fluctuant and all that? You have ruled out tuberculous lymphadenopathy.
Yes, sir.
Now, what is there for you to say it's malignant here?
Hard inconsistency.
Fixed.
And also the history he gives, history of hoarseness of voice and difficulty in dysphagia, sir. I don't think tuberculous lymph nodes would cause hoarseness of voice.
No. You have to say first points for malignancy. Hoarse voice is there.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
No evening raise of temperature.
Hoarse voice. Okay. Yes. Okay. Correct. Go ahead.
What is your probable clinical diagnosis?
Metastatic right cervical lymph node, stage N2B with unknown primary, sir.
Why do you say unknown primary, man?
Smoker with no most history of hoarseness of voice.
Most likely from larynx.
Most likely from the larynx or the upper esophagus.
So you have to say that. Metastatic nodes, most probable site of primary is this, because at least you have some history supporting your diagnosis. Now, how are you going to confirm this?
First, we'll finish with the routine investigations and moving on, we'll...
See, what is the question? How will you confirm your diagnosis? Stick to the question.
Go ahead with a pan endoscopy, ma'am.
An ultrasound neck.
See, you first said, you said your nodal status. It is a metastatic.
Yes.
You should have the history of primary organ involvement. You said there is a grade 4 dysphagia. So you have to say this is probably likely to be a metastatic node from the upper part of the aerodigestive system. This is reasonably accepted because it's a clinical diagnosis. This is a cause etiology. Everything has to come under your history itself. You have to finish your history itself.
Ultrasound of the neck followed by pan endoscopy, then FNAC of the node to confirm the origin, whether it's squamous or adenocarcinoma, followed by CT neck.
First will you do endoscopy or FNAC?
First we'll do endoscopy.
What is your endoscopy finding here?
Sir,
done or not done?
Not done, sir.
How does the secondary neck present as? It usually presents as a node that is more than 5 centimeters always. Okay? Never a 1 centimeter or 2 centimeters node. It just comes as a 5 centimeter, more than 5 centimeter node. Yes? And should it be in the upper aerodigestive tract or can it be in the mediastinum also or in the chest? Secondary neck can occur, no? Primary in the chest or in the upper aerodigestive tract also. Now, how do I know that this is the upper aerodigestive tract and not the chest?
Symptoms in favor of upper aerodigestive tract like dysphagia and hoarseness of voice.
No. By the involvement of the level of nodes. I'm not talking about the history now.
We can able to make out the lower border, ma'am. So, if it were...
No,
the nodes, which level will get involved when you have a primary coming from the chest, a bronchogenic carcinoma, where will the metastatic node be? That is madam's question.
Ma'am, level 6 and level 7, ma'am.
So, it is a lower one. Level 4. If it gets level 4 and 5, then you talk about
more of
the
upper,
chest.
Up.
Okay? Yes. Here it is level 2 and 3. And then involvement of the level 4. So, you think it is upper aerodigestive tract, even if the patient doesn't give any history. Do you understand? So, these are all just given in your books. Yes, pointers. Just to say that it is this, that's all. Got it?
Yes.
Yeah.
If there is a lesion in the mediastinum, which node you will biopsy? Supposing
the primary. Primary node will have to biopsy.
No, I am talking about which node will be involved. If there is a mediastinal pathology, what will be the node you will be looking for in the neck?
Level 7, sir.
Scalene group of nodes. There is something called scalene biopsy, where you will do scalene pad of fat. That is a marker for what is happening inside the mediastinum. Madam was asking, it could be chest, no? Okay. So this patient is metastatic, fairly advanced. Diagnostic will be... tissue diagnosis also will be there. Only when it's not there, you will plan FNAC. I think we can move on to the next case.
Yeah. Next case. No, I'm talking about the levels. Yes, sir, illana treatment for a puppy.
Lala, how are you going to proceed? You said endoscopy. If endoscopy is positive, you take a biopsy. Endoscopy is negative, not able to make. What will you do?
Then we take a surveillance or blind biopsies from the following, sir. From the tonsils and the tonsillar bed, from the subglottis, from the posterior one-third of the tongue, from the fossa of Rosenmuller and piriform sinus, adenoids.
Okay, you will work up towards the secondaries.
Yes.
Now, how do you manage now? You've done an investigation, you know it is in the, unknown primary. Then what are you going to do?
We can proceed with radiotherapy first, ma'am, and then move on with the ipsilateral radical neck dissection.
You said it is fixed already.
For example, FNAC shows it looks like a papillary tumor from thyroid, or it may be adeno, say, it can be a squamous cell, say, that is also important. So, FNAC is important to find out.
In this patient, it is most probably aerodigestive tract, squamous cell carcinoma, fairly advanced node. So what is your treatment? You have to say systemic therapy. Systemic therapy, it could be either chemo radiation combined or anyone in that order. No, better use your appropriate words. Systemic therapy, then reassess the patient. If the patient, the disease is nicely controlled with systemic therapy, read pre-op concurrent radio RT. Radio RT, there is a nice response, chemo RT. You have to probably think of doing a surgical procedure after the, depending upon the response. I think that will...
Last question. What will you do for that dysphagia? You said he is not able to swallow the saliva. What is the treatment you will give? So unless you make pathway for the diet, the radiotherapies and chemotherapies will not give therapy.
Self-expanding metallic stents, SIMS.
That will not stitch. You see, in the neck, you put a stent, it will be a foreign body sensation. It has to be at least 5 cm. Proximal tissues, proximal organ must be available for swallowing normal primary function. You cannot put a stent in the, I think Professor PKR sir is there. So at least you must have a 5 cm of esophagus normal to put a stent. So if there is a dysphagia, total block is there, you have to go for a feeding access. Feeding access through the either gastrostomy or jejunostomy.
Yes.
Yes, done.